your shed, Stuart, to be honest with you, is one of the great man sheds of all time. If there were prizes for man sheds, this is a gold medalist. You've got tools everywhere and lathes in there and bits and bats of archaeology. Yeah. And
oh, this all, it's something that's
unique,
great,
isn't it?
Yeah, but when I'm coming up for 77, you know, we're talking medium term here.
Stuart King has spent a lifetime researching and teaching the crafts and skills of woodworking in the Chilterns.
The chair bodgers were responsible for all the churned parts for the local chairs, particularly Windsor chairs, and they worked mostly in the woods. This was made for my grampy, Rupert King. It was made in the village in Holmer Green.
That is one fabulous chair that you're sitting in.
I've inherited this from my grampy. It's very typical, and it's got an elm seat, and the rest of it is beech, and it's extremely comfortable. Creaks a little bit, same as I do. And I look at this chair, and that lovely polished arm, I think, I wonder which local wood that come from. Was it Coleman's? Was it Hale Acre? I'll never really know, but I know it's all local. And the last three bodgers all packed up in 1959. And government contracts used to stipulate chairs from High Wycombe for government contracts would be bodger turned on the pole
lay.
Yes.
An industry, yeah, in your woods.
And if you walk in any of our ancient woodlands in the Chilterns, you'll see humps and bumps, boundary banks and ditches. You'll see enclosures. You'll see saw pits where the sawyers sawed up the logs into plank, but there's absolutely no trace of where the bodgers were because they had a very light footprint.
And so here we are, 21st century, and they're talking about making the Chilterns a national park. I mean, how do you feel about that?
Long overdue.
Do you think so?
Well, only because if it is awarded national park status, obviously that hopefully would give it protection against overdevelopment. In my own village here in 1850, we were about 300 souls. Now we're getting probably near 5,000, with the prospect of maybe another 900 homes in the near future. There is no plan that I can see that really considers the infrastructure needed. So, I think it would be very beneficial.
It's really fascinating to hear you talk about this landscape. I feel a sadness, actually.
Yeah.
When you talk about this extraordinary life that was here. Presumably lots of work has now gone to London.
High Wycombe was full of chair factories, large and small. But the housing alternative industries, whether it's electronics, plastics, IT, there are very few people working in furniture making. Holmer Green, which was a delightful little village, was once described to me by one of the planning officers as a commuter dormitory. So if there's a derelict orchard, farmer's field or large back gardens, yep, we can build on that because it's a dormitory for London. We've got this lovely rolling landscape, but no one goes picking cherries anymore.
You're going to make me cry.
I know.
That's so kind of heartbreaking. No one goes picking cherries anymore.
Well, no.
Because you get on a train and go to London and do whatever it is that people do in London.
If you want to buy some cherries, you'll see they come from South America or South Africa, where we used to produce all the cherries and other fruit that was required.